As a girl, when I was studying the cello, my hero was Pablo Casals. I loved his playing. And when I grew up, I found out that the whole world loved him just like I did. I'm Virginia Eskin. Let's toast Pablo Casals today on A Note to You. Every day, when Pablo Casals was alive, he would play Bach. He felt that it ordered his day, and interestingly, he would play it on the piano, because as a boy, he had studied the violin and the piano, as well as the cello. And then if he lived near a beach, he liked to take a walk in the sand, and those two things became a kind of a hallmark. And if you were ever around Casals, you noticed that's what he liked to do. So let's lead off with a very touching account of some Bach. This is for unaccompanied cello, and it's from the D minor suite. It's the first movement.
Thank you.
Well, you know who's playing. It's so expressive. It's Pablo Casals playing his beloved Bach. He was born in 1876, and apparently it was a very difficult birth because the umbilical cord was around his neck, and he practically strangled, and they got help so that he lived, and then eventually he's bitten by a rabid dog, and the family life sounds rather chaotic. Although his father was a good musician and started him on the cello at a young age, like with so many musicians and composers, the mother really steps up to the plate, and she does in this scenario too. And she determined that her Pablo would be a musician, and because the father even wanted him to become a carpenter, something that he could support himself with. And his first cello was kind of made out of a gourd, some kind of like a squash. And when he was 14, his father rewarded him, because he obviously was not to be deterred, with a real cello. And it was an important day, too, because they were taking a walk together, and they stopped by a little music store, and there were some sort of troughs outside with just loose sheets of music. And lo and behold, there was an edition of those Bach solo suites. So he got a full-size cello, and he got acquainted with the man who would become the cornerstone of Casals' life. The next pivotal thing that happens for Casals is that he hears a chamber trio from Barcelona in his little town. He's a Catalonian, so he's living near Barcelona in El Vedrell, and that really turns him on to chamber music. So he's furiously practicing the cello, and somewhere in there, at the age of 12, 13, he's enrolled in a music school in Barcelona, and the mother is really driving that bus, and lo and behold, he even gets to meet the queen, Queen Christina. And that's also another thing that happens for him throughout his life. He has the approbation of political rulers, kings, queens, and he's on his way. And an Irishman who had the unusual name of Count de Morphy, he changed his name. His name was Murphy, but he made himself into a count, probably had some money, and he was a sort of a cultural attaché to the queen's court. And between the queen and de Morphy, they decided that young Casals should go off to the Brussels conservatory to study. I don't know why they chose that, but they didn't like Madrid and they didn't like Paris. Maybe Morphy had a connection. So they sent him up there, and he was kept waiting for the audition, and the head of the conservatoire was very belittling of him and made fun of his size. And he often said, "I don't have to be any bigger. I'm as big as a cello, and that's fine, you know." And it's true, he was a short little man, but he was a tiger in that short little body. And he got really good and ticked off at the audition, and they kept him waiting and waiting and waiting, and finally he practically refused to play. And he did play, and he wiped the floor. All the other candidates were just in the dust. But he'd made up his mind. He didn't want to study if that's the way he was treated. So he and his mother pack up and they go back to Spain. And the queen is horrified. And she's so horrified that she cuts off the stipend, the money. And oh boy, that's very bad, because they were really depending on that. And that must have been a very hard time in his life, because he adored his mother and vice versa. And she had a younger child with them. And so they retreat to Barcelona, and they live in very bad cold water flats. And he's playing in cafes to support them. But she still believes in him. And he's practicing his Bach suites, even though he's playing at a wonderful place called the Café Toast. He's playing ice cream numbers and sort of florid things, not the kind of music that he eventually will become so well known and identified with. So let's hear another portion. This is a Gamba sonata, which would have been composed for that kind of instrument. You know, like a viola d'amore has more strings, and the Gamba also has more strings. So that when you play a Gamba suite by Bach on a regular cello, it's twice as hard because you have less strings. It would be like a pianist having only 6 fingers. You know, you need all 10. And I want you to listen just to a little demonstration of the kind of straight sound. And this is something that Casals invented. Nobody had done this before. The cellist draws the bow slowly across the string down near the bridge, and the left hand absolutely is still, almost like a cat caught in the headlights of a car. And it takes great nerve to do that, because all string players are trained to make a beautiful sound. And so what you have to do is train it out of yourself to make not an ugly, but a very plain sound. And then when you add the vibrato, oh boy, it just tears your heart out, or it just makes the hair stand up on your head. And cellists who had the privilege of studying with him never stopped talking about it, and he had the most effect on all string players. So let's listen to a movement here played by Casals of the G major Gamba Sonata. We're just listening to Pablo Casals playing with Paul Baumgartner, and I was very touched by that. There's something so intimate about his sound, and could you hear how he never slides? He's too much of a purist, and there's also this quality, it's never show-offy at all. That was the adagio movement of the G major Bach Gamba Sonata. And the only thing that you can fault him with is that he does tend to groan a little bit. So Casals is building a career for himself, and he travels widely. When you look at all the cities, he's in St. Petersburg 1 month, and then he's in Paris, and he gets himself over to New York at the turn of the century, and things are going well, and his mother's belief in him is paying off. And he's even awarded the Order of Carlos III. And he's making a lot of money, and he even buys a very elaborate villa, and there are photographs of it, beautiful statues and formal gardens and French elegant furniture. That's all going along nicely. And then by the 20s, he is aware of the politics in Spain, and he doesn't like what he sees because he was an artist with a conscience. And in that way, he's like his very good friend, Schweitzer, who also played Bach a lot. So by 1936, when the Civil War breaks out in Spain, he vows he will not live there, period. He really doesn't approve of Franco, and the way he can protest is by refusing to live there. And by the spring of 1939, he takes up residence in Prades, which is in southern France, right on the Spanish border, and he likes it there. And that's when he becomes a conductor. So let's listen now to a movement from a Brandenburg concerto with Casals conducting. A portion of the Allegro movement from the fourth Brandenburg concerto, and we had Pablo Casals as conductor. And he was ahead of his time because he established that Prague festival back when there weren't a lot of summer festivals. And his conducting career took off. He had a way of insisting that everybody played like a soloist. And when you listen to the playing, whether it was there in Prague or eventually at Marlborough or in Puerto Rico, that's what distinguishes Casals. He made the music so important. He had a wonderful metaphor, and he used to liken musicians to being a tree. And he had a kind of tremulous voice, and he'd say, "You are like a leaf, like a leaf." And if somebody didn't play individualistically, he could tell by looking at the bowing. He'd say, "You play like a tree. You are a leaf." Casals has a very important life at this point because he's now standing up to somebody like Franco, and you get a lot of brownie points for doing something like that. That's a very conscientious thing to do in the 40s. It's just like his music. There's a clarity and an intelligence about this man, and he does stand on those principles. And even though he gets into trouble sometimes with managers over issues of money, there were the Prague Festival almost bankrupted itself because he was accused of keeping money. And in fact, he wasn't. He was actually siphoning off money and sending it back to people in Catalan. So it's a very interesting life, the life of Casals. He wasn't just an ordinary cellist. Let's listen now to a portion of the Boccherini B-flat concerto. And I also have to add that he restored this concerto. It really hadn't been performed since Boccherini composed it back in the Baroque period. And as he plays, imagine that he's telling you the story of the piece. There's a subject and predicate quality to his playing.
Thank you.
Boccherini's B-flat Cello Concerto, played by Pablo Casals with the London Symphony Orchestra. Sir Landon Ronald was the conductor. That recording was made a long time ago. Nowadays, there's so much emphasis on beautiful tone, and I think cellists would do well, speaking as an old cellist myself, to go back and listen to how Casals explains music. He's not interested in the beautiful sound or sort of nanny goat vibrato. Not for him. He just wants this beautiful signal of the music standing there all just by itself. Today, we're thinking about Pablo Casals on A Note to You and his contribution to the world of music. And if you have comments, I'd love to hear from you. Our address is A Note to You, care of WGBH Radio, 125 Western Avenue, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. The email address is anotetoyou@wgbh.org. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. In analyzing the repertoire that Casals played a great deal, and it has a huge swath to it. I mean, he's playing early music, Bach, Boccherini, and then he's playing a lot of chamber music, Beethoven and Brahms. And then along with that, he champions somebody like Max Bruch, who wrote a very beautiful tone poem. It's called Kol Nidrei for cello, and it's become very popular. It's often played in temples to this day. Bruch was not a Jew, and people sort of thought because he wrote this Hebraic melodied tone poem that he was. But the piece is a wonderful expose of the sad, mournful quality that the cello can have. It doesn't have to be an intellectual instrument the way Casals so often used it. And listen to the way he plays the theme now. It's in the great, what I call the Jewish key of D minor, the national anthem of Israel. And Mendelssohn loved the key of D minor. And so Bruch, of course, composes his tone poem in D minor. And it's very Jewish sounding, this theme. A great lament. And listen to the way he plays. It's you just can't turn your ears away. He's in your face with it. He demands your attention. Here's Pablo Casals playing Kol Nidrei. That was Casals playing the Bruch tone poem Kol Nidrei with the London Symphony Orchestra. And again, that was made a long time ago, but the sound is so unbearably beautiful. The quality of him, he just insists upon you listening. He tells you the story of the music, and I think that engaged people, and people would sit there. I remember watching when he would play, tears would be streaming down people's faces. They took it as a personal thing, and that's a rare gift in a performer. We're going to hear a piece now composed by Casals. Apparently, when he was sometimes upset by various political regimes, he would take up his pen and compose a hymn. But he didn't write trios and sonatas. He wasn't active as a composer. Just a few pieces exist from his pen. And the piece we're going to hear now, Sardana, takes its inspiration from his native homeland. It's a national dance. It's a circle dance from Catalan. So we're going to hear a very fleshed-out version for 40 cellos. It was originally written just for 8. This is Sardana by Casals.
Thank you.
clever little piece. That was Sardana, written by Pablo Casals, and it was played by the 40 cellos of the combined London Philharmonic, Royal Philharmonic, and the BBC Symphony Orchestra, and the Philharmonia. It was a very plummy version. And I would add that he intersected musical history at a very, very interesting time. He apparently met Scriabin and Rimsky-Korsakov and Glazunov and Rachmaninoff, and he was very good friends with a fellow Spaniard. He called him his beloved Granados. And, of course, he would have played his music along with the Russians. And he seemed to get involved with interesting women, too, I will say. He had at least three or four wives. It's unclear whether the first wife was ever sanctioned with marriage. She was a cellist, Sugia. And then he got involved with a rich American, Susan Metcalf. And then eventually he gets involved with a very rich noblewoman. And the last wife reminded people, they said, of his mother. And in fact, Martita, the last wife that Casals had, is a dead ringer for his mother. And she was born in Mayaguez, which is the city in Puerto Rico that Casals' mother had been born in. So there's an interesting coincidence there. Now, he continued to sort of stick up for principles, and there's an interesting story. He had been hired to play at a concert, and the beginning of open rehearsals, where they were able to charge audience some money for being allowed to come to a rehearsal, and he was supposed to, at the end of it, tuck on a Bach solo suite, because that was his signature, and he was very ticked off at the amount of money, though, that he was being given, and he felt that the musicians were also being used. So he went out to the rehearsal, and he played as had been agreed upon, but then he refused to play the Bach solo suite, and the manager said, go on, play it. The audience is expecting it. And he said, no, I won't, not for this fee. And you might assume that he was just a very prickly man, but what he felt was that the musicians were not being paid enough also. So he stuck to his guns, and in the end, he gave away the extra money that he sort of demanded from management. And that's another theme that runs throughout his life. He gave away a lot of money to either Catalans or to other Spaniards, or he was a very philanthropic musician, and that's a kind of an unusual thing. You don't hear of many musicians who are even in a position to give away money. And way back in 1905, he meets two extraordinary musicians, and they form a trio, and they play together really for about 30 years. And the violinist was Jacques Thibault, who was a major artist, and Alfred Cortot, who was also a very major pianist in his own right. And they popularized chamber music. And nowadays, it seems, you know, just sort of a done thing. But that was not true. There were soloists in those days, or there were chamber musicians, and most musicians didn't do both. And certainly pianists didn't do both. And Sarkin was unique in his way of being a soloist and also a chamber musician. And then eventually he's like Casals. He starts a whole music festival up in Marlboro. So his impact is felt in many regions. And we're going to hear now this famous trio. We're going to have a movement from the great Archduke trio written by Beethoven. And I just want to point out that there's an interesting thing that's happening with these three musicians. Again, there's a dialogue, and the movement we're going to listen to is the scherzo movement, because I want you to hear how clear the playing is. And it's basically just a B-flat scale that Beethoven is playing around with. It starts. And then goes on. And then the piano comes. And listen to how clear each voice is. And that's unique because Casals demanded that. The pianist, I think, hardly touches the pedal. There's no blurring at all. And that's, I'd say that's really the hallmark of anything to do with Casals. Here's the Archduke Trio played by Alfred Cortot, Jacques Thibault, and Pablo Casals. Thank you. just heard a portion of the Archduke Trio, played by Cortot, Thibault, and Pablo Casals. Casals wrote a great deal of choral music, more than any other kind, and most of it seemed to be for the boys' choir of the monastery at Montserrat in Catalan. And he had formed an association with that monastery when he was teaching, way back as a young man in Barcelona. And we're going to end the program with a very beautiful piece that Casals composed. It's called Nigra Sum, and I want to read a little bit of the text to you, because it's very poetic. I am black and beautiful, and the king loved me and took me into his chamber. He said, rise, the winter is past and the frost is gone, flowers appear on earth, and the time of the pruning, that's the pruning of the trees, is here. So it seems a perfect piece for this time of year. It's Nigra Sum.
Thank you.
Well, that was a very gentle piece, Nigra Sum, composed by Pablo Casals. And it was sung by the Toronto Chamber Choir, David Fallas, conductor. And Casals almost lived 100 years. He died in 1973 at the age of 97. So, obviously, he had a long, full, and meaningful life. Whether it's the world of cello or the world of music, our lives really were touched by a very special person. I hope you've enjoyed our program today. We enjoyed putting it together. Our engineer is Alan Mattis. Our producer is Alan McClellan. And I'm Virginia Eskin. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. It's produced by Northeastern University in cooperation with WGBH Radio, Boston.